So I would like to thank everybody for coming tonight. My name's Ted Fisher. I'm the director of the Center for Latin American Studies. This is the first in a series of events that we're doing of fact-based, evidence-based interventions in contemporary... Yes. Who knew you could get an applause line by saying that at a university? But we feel a double obligation as professors. We are researchers researching issues that we're debating in the public sphere right now, and we're pedagogues. So this is something that my friend Bart Victor told me the other day. We have a double obligation to do interventions like this. I'm going to introduce Spring Miller, who is our moderator tonight from the Vanderbilt Law School, and she will introduce our panel.
Hi everyone, good evening. It's really nice to see you all here. On behalf of the Center for Latin American Studies, the Vanderbilt International Legal Studies Program, and the Turner Family Center for Social Ventures, I'm very pleased to welcome you to tonight's roundtable discussion on trade and migration with Mexico. And thanks to the First Amendment Center for hosting. We're very fortunate to have with us this evening three panelists with deep expertise in U.S.-Mexico relations who are going to help us cut through rhetoric and make sense of facts regarding this bilateral relationship. So I don't think I need to do much talking to convince you all of the timeliness of this topic or of the need for informed, thoughtful dialogue about it. But I will just say, for those of us who were in this room a couple of weeks ago when the Center for Latin American Studies hosted a dialogue about the meaning of border walls, including in the U.S.-Mexico context, tonight's conversation sort of feels like an important next step. As we heard at that panel, border walls are full of sort of socio-psychological significance for people living on both sides of them. And the proposal to build one along the entire southwestern border sort of sends a powerful signal to people in both countries about a possible reshaping of this bilateral relationship. So now it's time, I think, yep. Oh no, is this one not working?
Let's just give you,
I'll just take that one. Yeah, that's good. Thank you. Sorry about that. So I will just, I think now is the time for us to dig a little bit deeper into what a reshaping of the U.S.-Mexico relationship might mean. What are the sort of social and economic and political dimensions of that relationship, and what would a thorough kind of revisiting of them look like for people living on both sides of the border? So again, we're very lucky to have the three speakers with significant expertise in these matters addressing these questions tonight. I'm going to introduce them. They'll each speak for about 10 minutes, and then we'll look to you all for questions. So we're going to start with Larry Harrington, who's immediately to my left. He has extensive expertise and experience in leading multilateral investment institutions and the private sector in Latin America. His most recent assignment in Latin America was as representative of the Inter-American Development Bank in Mexico, where he managed the bank's $5 million portfolio and was a member of the diplomatic corps. Prior to that service, he was appointed by President Clinton and twice confirmed by the Senate as United States Executive Director and Alternate Director of the IDB and the Inter-American Investment Corporation. Mr. Harrington has been a public policy scholar at the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars and currently serves as an advisory board member of the Wilson Center's Mexico Institute. He also has extensive political and legal experience at the federal and state levels, having served, among other things, as part of presidential transition teams in 1992 and 2008, and served more recently as the chief policy deputy for the Attorney General for the state of Tennessee. Then next, we'll hear from John Hiskey, who is an assistant professor and associate chair in the Department of Political Science here at Vanderbilt. Since the mid-1990s, when he first visited the Port of Veracruz to conduct fieldwork, Professor Hiskey's research has focused on the causes and consequences of Mexico's uneven transition to democracy. This work led Professor Hiskey to explore the political and development implications of migration for migrant sending communities in Mexico. And then most recently, his research has focused on the role that crime and violence play in immigration-related decision-making amongst Central American communities. He is the author of numerous articles on these topics in journals like the American Journal of Political Science, the British Journal of Political Science, Comparative Politics, and Comparative Political Studies. And then we will hear from Christopher Wilson, who is Deputy Director of the Mexico Institute at the Woodrow Wilson Center, where he leads the Institute's research and programming on regional economic integration and U.S.-Mexico border affairs. He's the author of Working Together, Economic Ties Between the United States and Mexico, and co-author of The State of the Border Report, both of which were published by the Wilson Center in 2011 and 2013. Respectively. He has testified before the U.S. Congress and is regularly consulted by national and international media outlets regarding U.S.-Mexico relations. He's written opinion columns for multiple outlets and previously worked as a contractor doing Mexico analysis for the U.S. military and as a researcher at American University's Center for North American Studies. So we have a great panel. Now we'd like to hear from them. Again, each of them will speak for about 10 minutes, and then we'll open it up for questions.
I'll pull this over this way. Can you hear me? Yeah, is that working? Put my glasses on. Warren Beatty's older than I am, and I convinced his problem last night was he did not have his glasses on. You know, I was sort of looking at the Mexican newspapers this morning, and one thing that struck me is, you know, we talk a lot about integration and how Mexico and the U.S. are closer now than they were ever before. And if you want any evidence of that, look at this morning's newspapers in Mexico City, and there is as much about the Oscars as about anything else, which gives you some sense of how we are connected these days. I'm just going to do a brief overview of Mexico 101 politics and the economy, and leave trade and migration to the specialists. I think it's important to get a couple of things out on the table. One is the size of Mexico. When I lived in Mexico, people would come to see us and they would say, boy, Mexico's bigger than I thought. And I'd say, well, yeah, Mexico City's a big city. No, the country, it's bigger, it's got more people. And in fact, it does. Mexico has, as of today, about 129 million people. That's about 40% of the United States population. It's about five times larger than Iraq was in 2003, in case the Twitter-in-chief has any ideas following up on his remarks and his conversation with Peña Nieto. So it's a big country with a lot of people. 25% of the population is 15 years of age or under. So it's a relatively young country, even though there's been a trend towards smaller families as it's become more urbanized. It's considered a middle-income country in World Bank speak, with a per capita annual income of just under $10,000. That's a figure that masks a good deal of poverty. About 40% of the population is considered to be living in poverty, and that's possibly not coincidental that it's possibly not coincidental that about half of the jobs in Mexico are still in the informal sector, the folks you see selling things on the street, street vendors, food vendors, that sort of thing, who probably don't pay that many taxes and are not integrated into the financial system. Mexico was once a closed economy. For the economists among you, big in import substitution, but now it's a very open economy. Mexico, in addition to NAFTA, Mexico has more bilateral trade agreements than any other country its size. Although still 80% of its exports go to the United States. Chris will talk a lot more about the implications of that. But it's also a major importer of U.S. agricultural products. $2 billion of corn a year, for example. It's our largest purchaser of pigs, of rice. I talked to a friend of mine the other day about pork. He said, well, the pork farmers that he works with were sad about TPP not being approved. They thought that would be good for their exports. But the problem, if we blow up NAFTA, those pigs are already mortgaged for Mexico. So blowing up NAFTA would not be a good thing for pig farmers in Tennessee or anywhere else. Mexico's experienced growth since the tequila crisis, big economic crisis in the mid-90s. But it's never been able to get quite the level of growth it desired. It's tended to range in the 2-3.5% range and down to the 2% range this year. Recently, as recent as 2013, there were constitutional reforms opening up the energy sector to foreign investment, which promised to spur growth. But low oil prices, serious problems with the national oil company Pemex, corruption scandals, including a bungled handling of a disappearance of 43 university students, really have damaged economic growth and hurt the credibility of the existing government. And then there are external shocks, quote unquote, and a quote unquote complex external environment. And that's, again, IMF and World Bank speak, which would include the election of Donald Trump, which has sent the peso to a new low. It's come back a little bit. It's about 20 to the dollar. It's in this environment that Mexico, unfortunately, probably enters an election cycle. Under the Constitution, elections are set in for the first week of July 2018. And while official campaigning can't start under the law until 2018, party infighting and the primary process is already underway. So who says we don't export some things to Mexico? Mexico will elect a new president. The current president, Enrique Peña Nieto, cannot run for re-election to a six-year term, and with an approval rating in the teens, he wouldn't be re-elected if he did. They'll also elect senators, deputies, governors, and many of the 32 states, state legislatures, as well as hundreds of mayors and city council members. Unfortunately for Mexico, they adopted a federal system with term limits, and this has led to a lot of challenges in terms of corruption and security and other areas, maintaining consistency in administration, particularly at the subnational level. The 2018 elections will likely be among the most competitive in Mexican history. As you know, as many of you know, Mexico at one time had a dominant political party, the PRI, as it's called, for 70 years. That ended with the election of Vicente Fox, and again another party, the PAN party. Fox was a PAN member. Felipe Calderon was elected in 2006 by a very narrow margin. He was also a member of the PAN. And he defeated Andres Manuel Lopez Obrador, who's running for the third time this year in 2018. And you'll be hearing more of him. AMLO, as he is known in the Mexican press, is the current favorite. He departed the traditional leftist party and formed a new party called Morena. It's a growing party which had success in last year's off-year elections. AMLO is populist, left of center. Some say far left, but that's probably not really true. He has been accused of having authoritarian tendencies and playing fast and loose with the facts. Sounds familiar. In fact, Lopez Obrador has risen in the polls because he's seen as an effective counter to the new American president. On a campaign swing in Los Angeles recently, AMLO suggested that he would pursue international human rights charges against Trump if elected. Good luck getting a visa next time, I think. But given the lack of runoff, AMLO can win the presidency with as little as 20 or 25, 30, 32% of the vote. The party of Peña Nieto, the PRI, and the PAN will field candidates. There'll be independent candidates. But AMLO, at this point, is favorite. There isn't much doubt that relations with the United States, immigration, and trade will dominate the electoral landscape in Mexico over the next year and during this election dialogue. The recent meetings between Secretaries Kelly and Tillerson and the Mexican counterparts were characterized as productive and frank, quote unquote, which is diplomatic speak for really uncomfortable and we didn't agree on anything. And we'll probably be hearing a lot of those lines over the coming months. So the topics we're discussing here tonight are important. I didn't mention security, but I should, because it's one area where there's been a great deal of trust and cooperation over the last few years that's likely to be eroded, and really already has been eroded, by recent developments, I guess would be a good way to put it. And we'll discuss a little more of that later on. Some Mexicans in Congress, Mexican members of Congress, have suggested that they can retaliate for actions taken against migrants and attacks on NAFTA by stopping cooperation on security on all fronts. And that would be a devastating impact on our ability to control human trafficking, drug smuggling, et cetera. To give you some place sense of where we're headed, while the secretaries meet and they try to put a good face on things, for those of you who have been to Mexico recently know that particularly I think the immigration stance, and maybe more the comments that have been made by some members, one person in particular, but also members of the U.S. political establishment, have really had a negative impact on the way the U.S. is perceived. And indeed, they've had a negative impact on the way Mexicans perceive their own government, who they don't see standing up sufficiently with sufficient firmness to the United States. So I'm going to read a quote to you, and then at the end I'll ask you who you think said it. This is the quote in my Spanish translation, so bear with me. It's a quote, "We do not see firmness in defense of our sovereignty, or that we are being treated with dignity by our neighbor to the north. We don't see effective strategies to assist our fellow countrymen. We don't see an intelligent response by those responsible for attending to this humanitarian crisis. We call not only for a national but international solidarity to halt the racism, hatred, and terrorism emanating from the American president." So that statement was what, by AMLO, some other leftist Mexican politician, an editorial in Jornada, the traditional left-leaning daily tabloid? Nope, that was a statement from the Catholic Archdiocese of Mexico delivered at an event a few days ago as reported in the Mexican media. Look forward to your questions.
I speak pretty loud anyway, so I hope you can hear me. First of all, I'd like to thank the Center for Latin American Studies and the First Amendment Center and all the other organizers for this wonderful event, wonderful series of events. As Ted was saying earlier, I think it's just vitally important to have these kinds of discussions given what's going on in our country. For the next 10 minutes, I hope, I'm going to do my best Joe Friday impersonation. Anybody get that joke? Joe Friday, just the facts, ma'am. Okay, so so the people under 30 probably didn't catch that, but so I am going to present just the facts as opposed to the alternative. But I hope the ones that I provide to you will help give certain perspective on current discussions of immigration and, quote, what to do about it. The three points of focus for these facts that I'm going to give to you are the following. Number one, I want to talk about current trends in migrant flows across the U.S. border. Secondly, I'm going to talk about factors contributing to those flows, okay, what's causing the migration flows that we're seeing in recent years. And then finally, I'm going to talk about the U.S. response to those flows, what's been the policy response of the U.S. in recent years. All right, so let's start with current trends in migration. A 2015 Pew report estimates that more Mexican-born migrants between the years of 2009-2014 left the U.S. and returned to Mexico than came to the U.S. Okay, so the estimate of this report is about 1 million Mexicans have returned in that five-year period. 60% of those are, based on a survey conducted by on the Mexican side of the border, are estimated to have returned for family reunification reasons. Only 14% reported that they had been deported from the U.S. But basically what this says is that more Mexicans are leaving than coming to the U.S. in the past 5 years. Okay. That, however, those data are estimates, and they're now a bit dated, 3 years old. It's difficult to get accurate numbers on the precise numbers of Mexicans returning to Mexico for a variety of reasons. And traditionally, people who study migration flows between the U.S. and Mexico have relied more on Border Patrol apprehension data. So how many migrants or individuals are being apprehended at the U.S. Southwest border? Okay, so let's look at those numbers. In 2000, 1.6 million Mexicans were apprehended at the U.S. southwestern border. Okay, that was an all-time high. In 2010, this number had dropped to 400,000. All right, so a drop of 1.2 million in the span of 10 years. In 2016, that number was cut in half to 196,000 Mexicans being apprehended at the border. So what we've seen in the past 16 years has been a historical drop in the number of Mexicans being apprehended at the U.S. southwestern border. What this suggests is that the concern about Mexicans streaming over the border are misplaced. But that's my opinion, it's not a fact. The facts are that the apprehension data provided by a U.S. Border Patrol is about 200,000 in 2016. That 190,000 Mexicans apprehended at the U.S. border in 2016, that's the lowest number since 1973, okay? So if you look at a trend line of apprehensions of Mexican migrants, it's about as steep as you can get in terms of what's been happening over the past 15 years. I'll get to the reasons, or some of the reasons for why this might be the case. At the same time, in 2000, 28,000 non-Mexicans were apprehended at the U.S. southwest border. And when non-Mexican is the category the Border Patrol uses to classify anyone they catch who's not born in Mexico, most of those are coming from Central America. So in 2000, that number was at 28,000. In 2016, that number had increased to 218,000. All right. So what we're seeing is a trend line of apprehensions of Mexicans going down as fast as you can, as you can imagine, and the trend line of Central American apprehensions going up, not quite as steep, but certainly a significant increase in the past 16 years. The takeaway from these numbers, oh, and I should say, in 2014, for the first time since Border Patrol was collecting these data, non-Mexican apprehensions outnumbered Mexican apprehensions. Okay, so there's a fundamental shift in what's going on in the southwest border that I don't hear much talk about. And that shift is fewer Mexicans are crossing the border and many more Central Americans are. Okay, so what are the factors behind these current trends, this shift in what we're seeing happen at the border? Let's start with Mexico and the decline in Mexican migration. First of all, yes, the Mexican economy has had its struggles, but in part, I would argue, in some states, due to NAFTA and foreign investment, the Mexican economy has done quite well. Interestingly, some of those states also happen to be the leading sending states in Mexico. So those, the leading sending states, that is the states where the most migrants are coming from, tend to be in the central western part of the country. Guanajuato, Michoacan, Jalisco, Zacatecas. As a side note, that's where U.S. labor recruiters went in the 1920s to get to recruit Mexicans to bring them to the U.S. to work in the Southwest. And it's no coincidence that that's where the main migration sending states are today. That said, over the past 15 years, those very same high sending states have also been among the most successful states with respect to economics. The average growth rate for Mexico in general between 2010 and 2015 has been 3.2%. Not great, but certainly given the 2009 crisis, a fairly robust recovery. In Guanajuato, the leading migrant sending state, in 2015, that state's economy grew by 6.4%. It's booming. In Jalisco, the second leading migrant state, that economy grew at 4.7% in 2015. All right, so we have states that are sending migrants, but arguably, and I don't have facts or evidence to back this up, arguably at a lesser rate than they would if these economies, these state economies, weren't doing so well. All right. So there's the economic factors that may be adding to this decline in Mexican migration. There's also a significant growth in the Mexican middle class, also perhaps contributing to this decline in Mexican migration. I think more fundamentally is the Mexican demographic story behind the decline in Mexican migration. The fertility rate, the peak fertility rate, that is the number of children per female, reached its peak in the 1960s of 7 per woman, okay? That rate has declined to 2.1, barely at a population replacement rate in 2010, okay? The percentage of the Mexican population under the age of 15, while still a sizable proportion, is in 1970 was 47%. So close to half of Mexico's population in 1970 was under the age of 15. One thing we know about migration is that the age range for migrants generally falls between 15 and 35. Once you get past 35, you tend not to want to migrate anymore, okay? And that's a pretty consistent finding across different countries, different migration flows. So in 1970, again, close to half of Mexico's population was arriving at the age of wanting to migrate, or being migrant eligible, if you will. In 2010, that number had dropped to 27.9% in terms of the under 15 population in Mexico. What does this mean? Mexico's population is getting older. The baby boom of the 60s and 70s has passed, and that was arguably reflected in the boom in migrants in the 1980s and 90s and early 2000s. So if you talk to a demographer, they will assure you that migration from Mexico over the next 50 years is not going to be a problem. They will, the demographics just don't support the continued rate, the rates that we've seen over the past 20 years. Okay, so that helps, I think, to explain part of what's going on with the decline in Mexican migration. And this is in the context, mind you, where tremendous violence has been taking place in some states in Mexico because of the war on drugs taking place in that country, okay? So it's not been in the best of conditions, but even with those horrific conditions, we've seen this significant decline in migration. So let's turn to the rise in Central American migration. I know I'm running out of time, but I'll keep it short on this. Simply put, crime and violence are pushing people out of Central America much more than economics of the economics of the U.S. is pulling them. El Salvador and Honduras have been trading places as the most violent countries in the world. And in research that I've done, what we find is that if you ask an individual who's been a victim of multiple crimes in the previous 12 months, are you thinking about immigrating? They are two times as likely to say yes to that question as a non-victim is, okay? So essentially, what we have found through this research is two things. One, multiple crime victims are far more likely to want to migrate than non-victims. But more importantly, when we ask those multiple crime victims, do you know about the terrible U.S. immigration climate, that your chances of getting deported are much higher than they were last year? The risk to your life is much greater than it was last year? Their answer to those questions is a resounding yes, we know. 85% of Hondurans in a survey we conducted reported that deportations, they knew deportations were higher this year in 2014 than they were in 2013. They know very well what the U.S. immigration context is. But when we put those responses into our model of predicting who will say yes to I'm thinking about immigrating, those responses don't matter at all. That is, knowledge of the U.S. context, the immigration context, has no significance whatsoever in terms of the decision Central Americans are making with respect to migration. The one thing that stands out that matters is whether they've been victimized more than once in the previous 12 months. And that's about 10% of the population in Honduras who falls into that category. So it's violence, not economics, that's driving Central American migration. Second thing about Central American migration, they're not sneaking across the border in general. They are turning themselves in. The vast majority of Central Americans that arrived at the U.S. border in 2014, 15, and 16 are surrendering voluntarily to Border Patrol agents in an attempt to make an asylum claim. They're not sneaking across the border. So a border wall, for whatever value it might have, is not going to have any impact on those trying to seek asylum. Third factor that has played a substantial role in reducing the number of Central Americans that have arrived since 2015 is Mexico. Mexico implemented a southern border enforcement program in 2015 at the request of the Obama administration. And for the first time in many years, Mexico apprehended more Central Americans than the U.S. and deported more Central Americans than the U.S. Prior to this, Mexico let them go through. So Mexico clamped down on their border enforcement, their southern border enforcement. And this is, I didn't know this, it's from a Pew report. And this is astounding when you consider what I just told you. In the U.S., for unaccompanied minors who are apprehended at the border or who turn themselves in, 3 out of every 100 are deported relatively quickly. The other 97 are awaiting immigration court proceedings or awaiting a judge to hear their asylum claims. So 3 out of 100. You know what that number is for Mexico? Out of every 100 unaccompanied minors that they apprehend, they send 77 back almost immediately. So Mexico does a great job, if they want to, of serving as our frontline defense for Central American migration. All right. Finally, I'll turn to the U.S. policy response very quickly. If we accept that Central American migration, and particularly violence-induced Central American migration, is going to be the issue that we have to deal with most in the upcoming years, I would contend, and I'll provide some facts, but I would contend that we need to fix our immigration court system much more than we need to build a wall. All right, and let me give you some numbers on this. So, short of a complete abrogation of due process for those filing for asylum, remember, these are Central Americans are turning themselves in, so border enforcement is not going to do anything to that. Short of just completely denying any kind of asylum claim process, we are faced with a crisis in the immigration court court system. In 2014, the U.S. border enforcement budget, ICE and CBP, totaled $18 billion. For comparison, the FBI budget was $8.3 billion. What was the budget for the agency in charge of immigration court proceedings? $317 million. The average wait time for an immigration court proceeding in the late 1990s was 350 days. In 2015, the average wait time is 677 days for somebody who has initiated an asylum claim process. 677 days they are waiting with family members, or if the detention program goes into effect, they will be detained for 677 days average. The number of immigration court judges in 2002 was 215. The number of immigration court judges in 2012 had increased tremendously to 258. The number of Border Patrol agents in 2002 was around 10,000. The number of Border Patrol agents in 2012 was 21,000. All right, so the priorities of our entire border enforcement migration system, in my view, is misplaced. We have to fix the immigration court system if we're going to do anything else, before we do anything else. And I'll stop there. I could go on, but I'll stop. Thank you. No idea how long that was.
All right. Thank you all so much for being here. Thanks to Vanderbilt, the Center for Latin American Studies, for inviting me to speak with you tonight. I'm going to talk about the economic relationship between the United States and Mexico. And I'll start, as we were instructed to do, with the facts. It's a big relationship. It's a big economic relationship. The United States, Mexico is the United States' second largest export market, third largest overall trading partner. We have a bilateral trade of over $500 billion per year. That means that every day there is traded across the United States-Mexico border over $1.5 billion worth of goods and services. Every minute, that means there's $1 million worth of trade between the United States and Mexico. It's a big trading relationship. And the trading part of the relationship, of the economic relationship, is really the center of the economic relationship. That's the main piece of it. But that's just the start. It's not just a big relationship. If it's big, it does matter. I mean, that in itself makes it relevant. But there's something about the U.S.-Mexico economic relationship that makes it different than many other trading relationships and other economic relationships. It's a deep partnership. It's a deep relationship. What I mean by that is that we have a system of joint production, shared manufacturing platform that crosses North America at this point. This is because, largely it's because of geography. I mean, that's really the foundation of all of this, is the closeness between our two countries, the low shipping costs between the two countries, the short time to market between our two countries. But it's also because of policy decisions we made, like NAFTA, but as in also a number of other policies that have been put in place since then. So what this looks like, though, I mean, what this means to say we have a system of joint production is that as goods are being produced, especially big complex goods like autos, for example, there are parts moving back and forth, parts and materials move back and forth across the border multiple times during the course of production. There's, you know, some oil that comes out of the ground in Mexico that gets processed at a petrochemical plant in Louisiana, that gets turned into a plastic piece of a dashboard somewhere in Mexico, that get, you know, it, back and forth across the border. This is the types of things that we're talking about. And not everything moves many, many times, but when you look at it as an aggregate, half of US-Mexico trade is trade in parts and materials, not finished products. So half is trade in finished products as well. But that's sort of that traditional conception of what trade is, that it's, you know, one country specializes in producing one thing and another country in another thing. That's not quite what we do. We do a little bit of that. You know, Mexico is, you know, grows avocados, and we like to eat avocados, so we buy them from Mexico. We produce corn very well, so we sell a lot of that corn, mostly corn that goes as feed for animals in Mexico. But a lot of what we're doing, the biggest part of our trade relationship is in the manufacturing sector, and a huge chunk of it is in inputs to production. So our factories on each side of the border are feeding factories on the opposite side of the border. There are a couple of different ways of looking at this. There's sort of an old figure at this point. It's based on trade data from 2003. But based on that data, final goods imports, so not the parts, but final goods imports coming from Mexico into the United States contained on average 40% US content. It's a huge percent. The comparative figure for China in the same time, in the same study, was 4%. So what does that mean? What it means is that when we're importing goods from Mexico, we're actually supporting jobs and industry in the United States. Why? Because they're producing the parts that went into those goods, right? But across the Pacific Ocean, it's not very easy to have that same type of trading relationship. It's a much longer time to move things back and forth. It's more expensive to move things back and forth. And so you can't build up that same type of a trading relationship that we have with Mexico. Canada is the only other country that we have really that same level of integration with. What are the consequences of this? One, our business cycles are linked. We experience growth and recession, cycles of growth and recession together. You look at 2008-2009 recession in the United States. Mexico also experienced recession. Actually, GDP growth fell further in Mexico in 2009 than it did in the United States. Was there a housing bubble in Mexico? Was there a structural issue in Mexico's economy or finances? No. It's just because it depends so much. It's so tied to the US market. So our business cycles are now linked. But it also goes deeper than that. It means that our productivity, our competitiveness, is linked. Why is that? Well, if Mexico undertakes a series of reforms, actually as it did in 2012-2013, economic reforms that were designed to improve productivity, things in telecom, energy, et cetera, well, the cost of production in Mexico goes down. What does that mean? It means that producers in the United States get their goods that they use as inputs in their production at a better price. It means they can be more competitive. They can either sell their products at a lower cost, they can have a higher margin, they can fend off competition from China or from some other place, et cetera. They're more competitive as a result of that. And it works in both directions. If the US makes great investments in education and we're more productive as a result of that, well, that actually strengthens the opportunity for manufacturing in Mexico as well, because we're producing things together. Third, it means that if we put, I mean, this is for the sort of thinking about it in the current political context, if we put a big border tax in place, a big barrier to trade coming into the United States from Mexico, that big border tax on Mexico is also a big border tax on US producers that are feeding production in Mexico before it comes back to the United States. So, this happens to a certain extent around the world, because this is also globalization. But globalization is most intense regionally, in regional markets, regional production platforms, and that's what we have between the United States and Mexico. So I'm going to take that. That was my sort of laying out some of the numbers there. What I want to say and do just a little bit now is say, so if that's the case, if we have this relationship that's really mutually beneficial in many ways, why do we see this trade skepticism out there? Why do we hear things like NAFTA is the worst trade agreement ever negotiated? Well, I think we need to be, first of all, honest that there's a real issue that is at the root of some of those feelings. There's a real sense of economic insecurity that a lot of people and a lot of families feel in the United States. There's the fact that real medium household income is still below its 1999 peak in the United States, and finally just last year made it above the pre-recession peak, which was a lower peak than the 1999 one anyway. The fact that manufacturing job losses have been occurring in the United States since the late 70s, in a consistent way, although we've recovered a bit in the last years, that's really the overall trend is clearly still downward. And the fact that while we knew some of these challenges, some of these dislocations, manufacturing job losses would happen, both as a result of trade and a result of other things, I'm going to talk about them in just a second, we didn't realize there was a misdiagnosis, there was a misunderstanding in how difficult it was for people to transition from an industry where there are job losses into an industry where there's job growth. It's just harder than economists always assume, because new jobs are in different cities, new jobs require different skills, new jobs are hard to get for lots of different reasons. The biggest driver of these manufacturing job losses is, of course, technological change, automation in our factories. The manufacturing production in the United States continues to climb as manufacturing employment in the United States continues to decline. What does that mean? We're making more stuff with less people, right? Because we have robots making it, because we have computer-powered machines making it, et cetera. But trade and technology push in the same direction. This is really an important part of the political equation here, is that both of these changes, because trade, there's research from Ball State University, recent research that shows that around 85 to 87% of recent manufacturing job losses in the last 10 to 15 years are as a result of technological change, productivity enhancing technological change. Okay, that means there's around 13 or 15% that are related to trade and globalization related factors. So those are out there too. It's a real thing. With NAFTA, there were some very specific job dislocations from specific places. But on the whole, actually, there's also new, very good research that shows that actually the biggest part of that trade equation is trade with China. In fact, the research that shows that research suggests it may be a little more than 15% of manufacturing job losses that were related to trade. But they find that the shock of trade with China is the one that caused that. And then they apply the same model to Mexico, they get no result at all, actually. So the thing about these both is that they're both skill-biased changes. What that is that, you know, technological change is eliminating jobs on the sort of the factory floor, but it's creating jobs in some other places, the people that program the machines, people that service the machines, and we're seeing other jobs being created in the US economy that also happen to be jobs that require a higher level of skill in service sectors in the United States. Trade's doing a very similar thing. Why? Because we're opening up our economy to competition with other countries around the world, most of which are a little lower development status in the United States, meaning they have more of their population that are less skilled labor. So we have more competition being faced at that level of skill level. And so the United States, though we do well at where we excel, which is at the higher skill level. So both of these trends are pushing in the same direction, but it's much easier to have a vote or be mad about something that you can change, that you can have a vote about, which is trade, than it is about robots taking your job, or you're not going to have a vote against technological change, technological advance. And so I think as a part, one of the reasons, and I would say this is the only reason, but one of the reasons why we saw US-Mexico trade become such a part of this campaign is because it fits into this narrative. It gets related to this underlying problem. But I do think there's a misdiagnosis somewhere along the line in the middle there, where we say that the challenge is actually Mexico and US-Mexico trade. In fact, I would say that Mexico is actually part of the solution, potentially, for the challenge that we're facing. But a very important conclusion from this is that if Mexico is not the problem, then Mexico can't be the solution. It's basically that simple. If Mexico is not the driver of this manufacturing job losses in the United States, this sense of economic insecurity, this lack of household income gains, well then going and changing that relationship, shaking it up, renegotiating NAFTA, can't solve that problem. That puts us politically in a very challenging situation right now, because there's been a promise that's been made for the president to fight on behalf of the American worker. That's a very legitimate thing to do. I think it's a good thing. But you know, to be able to fulfill that promise through a renegotiation or a reworking of the U.S.-Mexico economic relationship is going to prove very challenging to do. It's not to say that there can't be little fixes along the margins that could have some positive impacts. You know, NAFTA was negotiated over 25 years ago. There certainly are some things that could be changed in there, that could be updated, that could be improved on behalf of the American worker, on behalf of the Mexican worker. But you can't solve the problem with that solution. And so we're in a tough spot there. And I'm just going to leave it there. We can have the rest in conversation. Thank you.
Okay. Questions? And when you ask your question, if you could please introduce yourself. Elliot. Go ahead.
Elliot Osmond. I have a question about the migration pattern from Central American countries to the border of Mexico. Do you have any figures on the number of people that have been caught at that southern border through enforcement by Mexico that would otherwise, without that enforcement, migrate all the way up to our southern border? Do you have any records, any numbers on that?
That's a good question. I don't have any hard numbers on that. It's dealing with the counterfactual. I mean, the assumption would be that the vast majority of them are trying to get to the U.S. border.
Well, if we continue to irritate Mexico, what do we expect them to do on their southern border?
Well,
if I were the president of Mexico, I'd say forget it. Let them flow right on through to, Ciudad Juarez. Mm-hmm.
There are reports from people, like contacts in Mexico, that there's a fairly significant increase in asylum claims of Central Americans in Mexico. And, you know, to Mexico's credit, notwithstanding the deportation of unaccompanied minors, my sense at least is that they are working on their asylum claim system more so than they have in the past. But that's my sense.
Okay. So when you hear Mexico saying right now, making public statements, saying things like, we want to have a comprehensive dialogue with the United States, what they're saying is, we don't just want to have a trade negotiation with the United States because we're not sure we have enough leverage in just a trade negotiation. So what they're saying is, things like managing Central American migration, we want that on the table next to things like an NAFTA renegotiation. When they're making statements saying, you know, making very clear how much they work with the United States in areas of security cooperation, preventing terrorists from ever entering Mexico and using it as a launching pad for the United States. That's, you know, it's implicit. It's behind the sort of the explicit message, but that's exactly what they're driving at when they say those things.
Yes, if you could introduce yourself.
My name is Christina Allen, and I have a follow-up question and my own question. But doesn't the U.S. fund the Mexican federal government for that southern U.S.-Mexico border with Central America? They funded to help get them a little bit.
USAID to Mexico total on security has been a couple of billion dollars over the last decade, essentially. That's a drop in the bucket compared to what Mexico spends on all these things. It's not totally irrelevant. I mean, it does help give the U.S. some leverage in negotiations, but it's not, you know, it's just not substantial enough for Mexico to worry about that much.
And then my question is, why is there so much more direct investment in the United States from other countries for manufacturing jobs, or is that incorrect?
The U.S. is one of the biggest receivers of foreign direct investment in the world.
But is it in manufacturing jobs?
Well, manufacturing in manufacturing production. But, you know, we don't get many jobs associated with manufacturing anymore, right? That's the challenge.
Japanese is where the number, Tennessee is the second largest foreign direct investment from Japanese, California being first. Is it, if it's not manufacturing, I mean, obviously our automotive, it would become that central part. But if they're investing in the in United States and others are, I mean, the manufacturing is not, a, I guess, an element, a variable anymore. So what are they investing?
Oh, no, absolutely our investments in manufacturing in the United States still. It's just that we're not getting many the bigger job return based on those investments anymore. Manufacturing production in the United States continues to grow. Now, and actually, Mexican investment in the United States has, it's up foreign direct, Mexican foreign direct investment in the United States is four times higher than what it was in 2005 at this point. It's still much less than U.S. foreign direct investment in Mexico. That's much larger. The U.S. is a much wealthier country. That's pretty normal, but it's actually growing quite quickly in the other direction as well. And so, yeah, I mean, this is one of the misconceptions, I think, is that the United States is not, you know, when we hear these narratives about jobs moving abroad because wages are cheap, right? That's the narrative that we hear. And so the immediate thing to think there is that therefore the U.S. is not competitive. You know, we don't have those cheap wages, so we're not very competitive in manufacturing or in other industries. The U.S. is incredibly competitive. I mean, the U.S. is one of the competitiveness in rankings, you know, by the World Economic Forum, put us in the top five worldwide every year. You know, they're looking at a lot of other variables, too. The cost of capital in the United States is really cheap. The level of education in the United States is pretty strong. The level of infrastructure, you know, there are lots of reasons to continue to invest, and that's why you see that Japanese investment.
There's a company called Magneti Marelli. It's in Pulaski, Tennessee. It's an Italian-based company. Biggest manufacturer is in Juarez, Mexico. And they now have a manufacturing where they're tripling, and there's more Mexicans running the Pulaski plant on a high level, and it's hilarious because it's Pulaski. But, and it's going to be the largest Italian base manufacturing for automotive lining. I just think that's funny.
So, Larry, you want to jump? You've
well, I was just, yeah, Ted was some of the Center for Latin American Studies. Did a paper, I think it was 2011, 2012, looking at foreign direct investment by Mexican companies in Tennessee, and the most, well, one of the most important items, for example, was the NEMAC, which is a Mexican-owned company in Dixon, Tennessee, makes auto parts, engine blocks, and it employs, you know, around 400, could be even more people. And there are about, this was pre Bimbo investment day, the bakery company, and which bought a big plant. So there are probably a couple of thousand jobs by now in Tennessee related to foreign direct investment by Mexican companies. Not a huge amount, but not insignificant.
I thought you were talking about the president, Bimbo.
Yeah, well, I did that too.
So I'm trying to understand the current political climate relative to everything you've said today. And aside from the undocumented, there people are here illegally, what is the administration's narrative aside from that that leads to them wanting or being willing to damage the relationship with Mexico? And specifically, what will the deportation of all these individuals, how will that impact our labor market, our labor force? I mean, I can come up with my own answers, but I'd rather hear.
Well, the narrative, you know, was very much about, I mean, what I was talking about. I mean, the narrative was one of jobs being lost in the United States, relocating Carrier, the HVAC company, the air conditioners. They closed a plant in the United States, and they were going to open a plant in Mexico. This happened during the campaign, and it became a fairly important campaign issue. Now, you know, when Ford announced that it was going to make a couple billion-dollar investment in a plant in Mexico, that became a campaign issue. Why? Because the perception was that that meant that that investment wasn't coming to the United States, right? That the decision was, do we do it in the U.S. or in Mexico? Mexico wins, U.S. loses. The perception, you know, the narrative was one that we're in a zero-sum game of competition, economic competition with Mexico, and that the United States is losing. therefore we need to change the terms of the game, right? We need to renegotiate NAFTA or throw it out. We need to put in a big border tax so that those, you know, low-skilled, low-paid workers in Mexico can't eat our lunch. I mean, that's driven quite a lot of what's happened. The challenge now is that regardless of what anyone in government actually believes, that narrative has, you know, those promises have been made, that narrative has been sold. And so now something needs to happen, something needs to change. And so, you know, there's a need to change some of the terms of the game. Now, how that happens and how that plays out, that's what we're all, you know, watching for. And I mean, I can speculate, I'd be happy to, but that's how we got here. On the economic front, I think there are multiple fronts to this, you know, the perception of Mexico in how it played in the election. And I think migration was another big piece of it.
With respect to the labor market, I don't have any hard numbers on that either, but I think all you have to do is visit a poultry processing plant or the dairy industry up north. So to find out the answer to your question, it's unclear to me where that replacement labor is going to come from.
But as a follow-up to that question, if our unemployment rate is about 4.7% in the United States, and we were to deport 11 million, quote unquote, or 11.2 million, which would never happen, God willing, our employment rate would actually drop to minus 2% if you wanted to look at it on an overall basis. So I guess that's where you're coming from in that question. So the question here is, how do we put it in terms that the U.S. population understands? Because quite frankly, they don't understand it now, all right? Because all they hear is, oh my God, they're here, they're taking our jobs, or our jobs are going to Mexico, or they're lowering wages here, although we don't want to raise the minimum wage, all right? So we need a narrative that works, and we don't currently have that narrative, I guess.
Well, I think the narrative, it's really not a narrative, it's impact.
Right.
When businesses start feeling an impact, the business community, which supposedly has supported immigration reform, and in 2010, 2009, when the immigration reform measures were before Congress, theoretically the business community was supportive, and they really didn't do a damn thing to really get out there and work. The business community has not stepped up for immigration reform. The question is whether they will step up once they see that they're not going to get their big tax cuts, or whatever, you know, whatever benefits they want from this president and this Congress. You know, are they going to get squeezed so bad that they will start stepping up? I don't know about average American voters, if, you know, we'll see. But I do think, I think the impacted, who is impacted are the businesses and the people who are trying to run a business. I spoke to someone who's in the meatpacking business a couple of weeks ago. They employ a lot of migrants. They actually employ a lot of refugees. They're worried about the refugee policy because they have a direct line from Catholic Church, different charities, and they'll have to close. I mean, if they can't, because American workers not only will, as he said, plants in rural areas, he said, not only do American workers, are they not willing to do these jobs, the ones who show up to do them can't pass the drug test. So it's, you know, the impact will eventually be there. The question is when and if it's soon enough.
My name's Eileen Teed. I'm a PhD student here. I have a question. I'd love to hear everyone's thoughts on it. But some of these migration statistics are really interesting and striking. And I heard them a couple weeks ago when we did the Teach and Learn In. And I mean, that's not the kind of information that the typical American citizen is necessarily exposed to. It's you know, contradicting the dominant, you know, the narrative. John, you don't have to convince me on these kinds of statistics. I mean, but my question is, I mean, what do we do with those statistics now? I mean, how do we make that kind of like mainstream and, I mean, get exposure to those kinds of statistics in terms of the fact that the way that we see migration and the way that it's going, the flows are not going. It goes against, you know, what the dominant ideology or what people are talking about. I mean, what do we do with that information? How can we kind of turn it into kind of practical action? I'm just curious as to what your thoughts on it. And then also you as well, Chris.
We're trying. Trust me, we're trying. We're trying to get it out there. And I've been to workshops with migrant advocates and people involved in this, and exactly about this question of changing the narrative. And, you know, we need better PR, I suppose. I mean, if you look for it, it's out there. I can't get into the minds of
Well, I mean, I think you do what people are now doing, and I think they should keep doing it. One of the things is that there's so much misinformation out there, and there are so many bad things that are happening that it's kind of hard to know what to focus on. But you do what people are doing right now, to a great extent, about the Affordable Care Act, about Obamacare. You go to a town hall meeting or some other event of a member of Congress, not necessarily in this district because he's pretty smart and doesn't really need the information, but if you happen to live in Williamson County or Wilson County or Sumner County, or you have friends there, you get them to go show up and you stand up and tell that member of Congress that they don't know what the hell they're talking about when they throw out a statistic that's absolutely wrong. Now, you're not going to change the mind of those people who, I believe, having grown up in the South, I believe there is an element of racism to the whole immigration issue. It is just there. It is no accident that the state after Arizona that passed the most egregious immigration bill was Alabama. I mean, you know, and we might as well now have George Wallace as the Attorney General. You know, there is an element of hatred of or discomfort of the other in the whole immigration debate. But at the end of the day, the statistics speak for themselves, and the only thing you can do is go out there and confront the people who are opinion leaders and elected members of the legislature and confront them. We're going to have, there are there's a handful of bills right now in the legislature that would attempt to federalize the local police forces in the state, to federalize local police. Now, these supposed conservatives that we have in the state legislature should be concerned about federalization of the local police. But nobody's really probably confronted them like that, and certainly no one has confronted them with statistics that tell them that it is unnecessary to take such a drastic step. So how do you get out? You go down there and you stand in the hall of the state capitol and you scream at them. That's what you do.
It's really hard, though. And here's why. I mean, I just mean from a narrative perspective, is because you go and you say all these stats, and I say, how many people did you say cross the border illegally every year? 400,000 they're stopping? That sounds like a lot of people to me. And it is a lot of people, frankly. And so if someone says, you know, is the border secure? 400,000 people every year. That's a really tough argument to win. We've walked ourselves into a corner because we have no definition of border security, so there's no standard by which we can have a coherent conversation about it. So instead, until the border's sealed, it won't be secure, right? And so we're at a point that's very difficult. I honestly think that from a narrative standpoint, I think this is a moral issue. This is an issue of families and lives is a stronger story to tell than just the stats. Now, I mean, it's important. It obviously has to be a part of the conversation. But I don't think that the principal cause of the situation we're in right now in migration is a lack of understanding of the statistics. I think that's a secondary issue.
Elliot?
Yeah, this question is to the entire panel. Are there any statistics or figures which indicate a growing awareness in the business community of the thin ice they're on the further this debate goes? The reason I ask that question, this is purely anecdotal, but about 25% of the consults I've been doing in my office for the last 3 months have been to business people and their valued employees who are who are scared about what is about to happen to their business. And it seems to me that there ought to be some way that we can utilize the business community to get through to the Republican majorities in Congress and the state legislature to talk sense to those people. Business knows how to communicate with the majorities in these governing bodies. And I just think there's a gap there. And I don't know whether the moral argument is going to hold that much sway any longer. I believe the business economic argument is going to have the greatest impact on the majorities that are controlling the governing bodies.
They're active. I mean, the business community is active. The Chamber of Commerce is out there on NAFTA issues, for example, in particular. I mean, but the big challenge that I see in speaking with them is that while the coalitions are speaking up, the individual companies are keeping their heads down. And they're keeping their heads down because they could get tweeted at and see their share price drop by 10 or 15% if they're not careful. Right? So, yes, there's a conversation that's going on. Yes, there's pressure that's going on. There's more stuff going on quietly behind the scenes in terms of conversations with specific members of Congress and that type of thing from the individual business perspective. But it's a big challenge to find companies that are willing to, be the narrative, to be a piece of the narrative. I mean, I get calls from the press all the time asking me for, if I can put them in touch with companies that might tell the story of their parts moving back and forth, the integration, the way they depend on Mexico as a market. And I can pass them on to companies, but it's very rare that the companies want to take part in those press stories.
We have time for one quick last question. Yes.
So, Chris, a question. I'm wondering your perspective on, we know a lot about what's happening in the U.S. and the rhetoric here and what people are saying here. I'm interested in what's happening in Mexico, this anti-American sentiment that's flourished as a result of this, and some of this calls for boycotts and not coming to the U.S. and not investing in the U.S. and not buying American products. I mean, does that have the possibility, the chance of moving the needle at all? What are your thoughts?
I'm still a little bit uncomfortable with the calling it just straight up anti-Americanism. I think there's a strong anti-current U.S. government sentiment.
Correct.
That's
correct.
Very clear.
Absolutely.
That it's
absolutely
exploding beyond that, I'm not sure of yet.
Yeah.
Now, it's something to watch for, it's something to be concerned about, but I'm not sure that it's there. But I mean, certainly, Larry mentioned it. I mean, we've seen the poll numbers in Mexico for 2018 elections change since the election of Donald Trump here. The candidate who is best positioned to take a tough stand against the United States is the one who is in the best position politically right now. That's not, that's not an accident. So absolutely, this is having an impact. And it's putting the current government in a very tricky position, because on the one hand, they need to be, not be seen as being pushed over by the U.S. administration, need to be seen as tough. But on the other hand, more than 70% of Mexico's exports go to the United States. They got to do what they can to keep the real live, day-to-day relationship ticking. Otherwise, it's a major problem for the Mexican economy. And so they're sort of in between those two really difficult spots. I think that as the election get closer, the response to tough rhetoric from the U.S. side will be tougher and tougher rhetoric from the Mexican side. I mean, we're already seeing that from the government, a sort of a strengthening of rhetoric. I mean, the article today was that, they said if the U.S. tries to change tariffs, add tariffs in an NAFTA renegotiation, Mexico will walk right away from that renegotiation, won't be a part. I mean, and that's just one example of it. I mean, I think, there's absolutely a series of responses on the Mexican side. I mean, like I was saying before, there's a decompartmentalization of the relationship. They're saying that everything's on the table now. They're saying that we're willing to use leverage wherever we need to get us to an outcome that's acceptable to us. But that makes sense. I can understand that. But that's an incredibly risky thing to do, right? Because that means the whole relationship's at risk now, not just sort of one piece or the other, but the entirety of the U.S.-Mexico relationship becomes at risk.
I mean, I did not, I'm going to just respond quickly. I didn't get into the security thing because I was going on too long, but I mean, it used to be under the, as you probably know, under the old system, drugs, there was not a great deal of interdiction in Mexico back in the 70s and 80s. It basically, they, you know, the drugs came up here, it was for the gringos, you know, unless you're doing something bad here in this country, you're selling it in this country, you're causing violence in this country, move it up, and you know, some people along the way get a little payoff, and it's not a problem. Terrorism wasn't that much of an issue back then, but now, as someone said, you fly into the Mexico City airport from London or wherever, you get checked just as if you were flying into JFK. We talked about Central America and the immigrants there. So there are a lot of things, and extradition. You used to never get an extradition from Mexico. They would never extradite a drug kingpin. Happened just the other day, last month, with El Chapo. I don't think we're going to go back to the old days where all that stuff just stops, where there is no real serious day-to-day work on security, drugs, terrorism, etc. But it could. That's why they're saying all this is on the table, and they are getting pressure, as the statement that I read from the Archdiocese indicated. I don't think on a person-to-person level in Mexico, you know, Mexican, one-fourth of every Mexican has a family member that lives in this country. There's a lot more, the relationship is stronger than it was on that level, but a hell of a lot of damage has been done in a very short period of time to the bilateral relationship. One quick question on the border tax that for Tennesseans I want to mention, because we may hear tomorrow night, Chris said there were rumors that if Trump puts anything in his speech of substance, that would be shocking, of course, but that if he does, he may say he's for this this border tax, quote unquote. That's essentially a sales tax on imported goods. In Tennessee, we already pay a pretty hefty sales tax. If you go out and buy a flat screen TV, you pay it for $200, TV, you pay about 20 bucks in sales tax. If that tax were passed, we would then, in Tennessee, you go out and buy a $200 TV, you're going to pay a $40 tax on that TV. So it's a very regressive tax, like our sales tax is. So there are tremendous implications to some of these policies that are being thrown out as a way to pay for the wall or a way to retaliate against Mexico that won't have any impact except to hurt average working people, especially in a state like Tennessee where we already have a high income tax.
I'm not cheering up.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you.
Interesting stuff.
Yeah. Wonderful.
Oh, thank you.